Well, this is Ann Zajac, and I'm back with the third of our short videos on small ruminant parasite management and the FAMACHA system. And FAMACHA is the focus of this program, but you want to recognize that successful parasite management should incorporate other practices as well. FAMACHA by itself doesn't help us with this serious problem with dewormer resistance to the exclusion of needing other things too. We have to combine as many different techniques of parasite control as would be feasible in your situation. And for more information on any of the things I'm going to talk about, go to wormx.info. There's plenty of information there. So there's really two ways to think about trying to control parasites in your animals. One way is to attack the worms in the animal itself. The second way is to try and reduce exposure to parasites on the pasture. And I want to just give you right now a little taste of some of the common techniques that are used for each approach. So if we look at attacking worms in the animal, I want to mention targeted deworming, genetic selection, copper boluses, and nutrition. Targeted selective deworming says we're only going to deworm the animals that need to be dewormed. And it turns out that in most circumstances, the majority of animals may not need to be dewormed because of low parasite challenge or highly effective immunity. And by not deworming animals that don't need it, we help maintain our refugia, and you remember that slows down the rate of development of resistance to dewormers. For routine selective deworming, FAMACHA is the best system we have for small ruminants, and that's going to be discussed in detail in the next video. Now, if I take any animal and say, how many worms are there in this animal? Well, it's going to depend on a bunch of things. Some of those factors are related to the worms themselves. So how many parasites are out there on the pasture to infect the animal? Are they drug-resistant worms? But there are other factors that are related to the animal itself. One of those big factors that I'm going to say a bit more about is genetic susceptibility. Other factors like age and nutrition and general health can also play a role, and we can work to improve nutrition and general health. But genetic susceptibility is a really important consideration when it comes to parasite management. We know that genes of the host animal, genes of sheep and goats, can affect their susceptibility to infectious agents in several different ways. And when we're talking about gastrointestinal nematodes, we're mostly talking about the immune response. Sheep and goats develop immunity that limits but doesn't eliminate the presence of these parasites. They can control the levels of them to a greater or lesser extent, but they can't get rid of them completely. This immune response is very complex, and it's made up of several components which we don't fully understand. It doesn't develop in animals fully until about the time of sexual maturity, and we all know that young animals are really the most vulnerable of all to infection with these parasites. We also know that sheep mount a better immune response than goats do, and that the immune response itself and how well it works can be reduced by poor health, malnutrition, stress, and also to some extent by lambing and kidding. Now, this individual genetic susceptibility to worms is based on inheritance. So animals can inherit this genetic component of individual susceptibility. It can be selected for, and it turns out it is as heritable as some other traits that we routinely select for, things like weaning weights. You can use breeds that are known to be more parasite resistant. In sheep, we know Katahdin sheep tend to be more parasite resistant. But you can also, within a breed of animals, select for more parasite-resistant animals. And you can do that by using fecal egg counts. And I just want to mention that the National Sheep Improvement Program offers an estimated breeding value for parasite susceptibility based on fecal egg counts. If this is something that would be of interest to you, you can check out their website. Another method we have for attacking worms in the animals are would be the use of copper oxide wire particles. Now, it turns out that copper oxide wire particles have an impact on barber pole worm that's like a moderately effective dewormer. We don't understand exactly how it works, although it may damage the exterior surface of the parasite. But the use of these wire particles is an option for use in targeted selective deworming programs, which we're going to talk about in greater detail. We also know, and it's important to keep in mind, that sheep are more susceptible to copper toxicity than goats are. So these copper oxide wire particles have to be used carefully, and you should do more reading on them if you're interested in using them. Another animal factor that I've touched on already is nutrition. Good nutrition is critical to an effective immune response to these parasites. And one of the ways that we've seen parasite management be improved on some farms is by increasing protein levels in those animals that are particularly susceptible. That would be young animals or lactating animals. You may actually speed up the development of the immune response to the worms by increasing protein levels, although this benefit isn't uniform. It depends a bit on the situation. You also absolutely have to have, for a good immune response, adequate minerals and vitamins. So if you have a parasite problem, always make sure that the diet is adequate for all nutrients. Now, we can also try and reduce exposure to parasites. We can try and impact the number of larvae that are out there to infect the animals. And I want to mention just a few things in relation to this too. One of them is that babies get the best. And what this means is you always put your most vulnerable animals on the pasture that has the fewest worms. That means your young animals go out on the pasture that's going to have the fewest worms on it. Lambs or lactating ewes and does, similarly, along with those lambs and kids, need to be on the pasture with the fewest worms. There may be some other situations where you have very vulnerable animals that need to be put on the cleanest pasture. Rotation and forage height can also make a difference in how many parasites the animals get exposed to. By removing animals from a pasture, larvae will die off with time, but the length of time that you keep animals off the pasture is critical. It may not coincide with optimal forage use, but you've got to leave it long enough for those parasite larvae to die. And we generally say in the temperate US states, you need at least 60 days minimum. You can reduce the length of time by taking a hay crop off a pasture that has regrown. So by harvesting forage regrowth for hay, you'll expose those larvae to desiccation. They do tend to die off faster. Now, forage height also is an element here, because most parasite larvae can't migrate up grass blades more than about 4 to 6 inches. So the longer forage will reduce exposure to the parasite. Similarly, when goats browse, that tends to also reduce exposure to parasite for the same reason. Usually when they're browsing, their heads are up higher. We've also found that diversification is good for parasite control. So that using a mixture of animal species on a pasture or alternating use of species on a pasture helps reduce the number of larvae, because each host acts as a vacuum cleaner for the parasite larvae of other hosts. Now, an exception to this is that when you have very young calves, you don't want to graze them on pastures heavily contaminated with barber pole worm, because they can, when their immune systems aren't very fully formed yet, they can be more susceptible to barber pole worm. There are a few other exceptions as well, but generally they're not of practical importance. Another thing we can do to reduce the number of parasite larvae out on the pasture is to use Nematophagous fungus. Nematophagous means nematodes that eat fungus. And there is a fungus called Duddingtonia flagrans, which is found worldwide, that feeds on nematodes. And when dormant fungal spores are fed to animals, they pass through into the manure. And in the manure, they germinate and put out this net of fungal hyphae that can trap nematodes and then kill them and consume them. And you can see in these illustrations here the presence of this nematode trapping fungus. They can't trap and consume other parasites like coccidia. It's just nematodes in our gastrointestinal nematode group. So there's an Australian company now that has created commercial products that are available in the US. One of them is called Bioworma, which is just fungal spores that could be mixed with food or mineral and fed to animals. The other one is Livimol, a nutritional supplement that contains Bioworma. So it contains the fungus. And those can be purchased here and used in small ruminants or other grazing animals. So these are just some of the techniques that can be used in addition to just giving deworming treatments that help control parasites, and should be part of an integrated parasite control system depending on what techniques will work on your farm.